You're in the system?
I'm in the system officially.
Oh, yeah, how'd that go?
I had my, all my fingerprinting done again for immigration, see if I can stay another 15 years, and...
But Dave didn't make it, huh?
His appointment is tomorrow.
Oh.
But as he's going through my records, he said, "Do you have all 10 fingers?" I said, "Yes." He says, "Well, we're missing your right index finger." I'm like, "Really? It never got recorded last time."
That's bizarre.
I know.
You have to do, now we have to match it.
So now I'm all in there.
Does everybody has a sheet? I'm gonna put them in the back in case somebody straggles in on us. So what did they use your toe last time or something, or?
No. Just wasn't there.
Just wasn't there.
It's possible that it didn't read properly. The technology has advanced in that.
Yeah, I had mine done not too long ago for the preschool. Boy, it's all digitized.
Yeah, you roll your finger across the screen. And,
yeah. It's kind of neat, actually. Especially if you're getting fingerprinted for the right reasons.
Right. No ink.
Yes. Yeah, no ink. Well, everybody, tonight we're going to get started. And hi, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Good. As you've noticed, based on the feedback, literally, we are recording tonight. We're just storing this on archive. And we've got a few people online joining with us, so if they have anything to ask, we'll take questions too, I guess, from other people. But that said, what brought you out? Curiosity? Or are you curious? Well, you put yourself on a number of field trips. We were talking earlier. How many of you have been on one of those? Or are you still on one? Terry says, every day? Yeah, and you know, when you think about a guilt trip, you know, I think Robin Williams used to be famous for using it as a line, you know, pack your bags, we're going on one of those guilt trips, and of course that's kind of become a quaint saying, but you know, it's not something that's pleasant. You know, guilt, and then even uglier and more troublesome than guilt is what we'd call shame. And we're going to talk about the differences as well as I think the similarities between those, and how one is one that the Lord uses, and one is one that the devil likes to use against us. So we're going to look at those a little bit in detail too. But what is a guilt trip in your mind?
Is it your conscience talking?
Your conscience talking to you? Okay.
You've done something you know is wrong, and
you've done something you know that's wrong, and so you're on a guilt.
So you feel
responsible.
Mm-hmm.
Terry.
Mine is kind of different. I feel responsible for others way too much.
You feel responsible for others
yeah.
way too much, yeah. And that's the question I was going to ask next is, is it a guilt trip something you put yourself on only and exclusively, or is it something that others might inflict upon you? And which is more so than not?
I guess something we put on ourselves is we like to blame other people to be putting it on us.
Sure, play the victim. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That blaming and defending kind of mechanism, yeah. And that's, I get it. And that's really to the point that I think a guilt trip is either something that, well, it's a deep feeling of regret, first of all. And that's a kind of a working definition if you wanted to put what is guilt. First thing is it's regret. A deep sense of I've done something or something has been done unto me and I feel responsible for it and I really, really regret that this has happened. And we might call that remorse in some regards, but I think guilt is a little bit more poignant than just remorse. I think remorse is just being sorrowful, but guilt is, I'm to blame for it. I'm the cause of it. there's that regret that I wish I could take back what has happened. I wish I could take back those feelings I have, or what I said, or how this all turned out. And it can be something, as we've identified, something that you can assign to yourself. You can put yourself on this because you're sensitive and you hold yourself accountable. Or it's something that was brought up just a minute ago that we can put other people on as a way of maybe making ourselves feel better, blaming somebody else in order to defend my position. We end up becoming that victim in the situation, trying to be innocent. So it sounds like, if just as we get an idea of this, that some of us allow others to put us on guilt trips, and others of us, we're our own worst enemy when it comes to it. Or is there an equal balance? Or do you see it maybe more one than the other in your life? Are you really hard on yourself, or do you let other people be really hard on you?
I'm hard on myself.
You're hard on yourself? And is that why you allow others to maybe, I don't want to say manipulate, but...
I'm the ultra sensitive. I want everyone to be happy. So
when, want everybody to be happy.
Yeah, so when things aren't going right, I blame me. Done it ever since I was a kid. I don't know if it's an older kid role, watching those little ducklings coming behind you.
You're the oldest sibling.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's some responsibility. The pecking order.
Yeah, so, you know, they do spank, and I wouldn't. I'd feel the guilt, whether I did it or not. I would feel so bad.
Let's hold on to that thought, the idea of feeling bad for others, because we're going to talk about that a little bit. And that's one, that can be a good thing. And I think we talked about that in weeks past, you know, having that empathy and sensitivity towards other people, and being able to be present with people, that's good. But when it turns on me and it becomes counterproductive, and then it becomes something that makes me less than effective and maybe dysfunctional in my own way of thinking and looking at myself, then we're on a problem path there. Yeah, we need to straighten out those train cars there. But keep that in mind. Feeling bad for others. I mean, I'll just throw it out there. Is it wrong to feel bad for others?
I think if it affects your well-being and even you spiritually, then it is not good.
And maybe the question to ask is, do I feel I have to feel bad for others? Because if I don't feel bad for them, that means I'm not being responsible. I'm not really caring about them.
I think there's a difference between empathy and taking responsibility for why they feel that way.
Yeah. Think that through.
Empathizing, understanding why they feel upset compared to being the cause of why they're upset.
Yeah. Am I responsible, or am I just sad? Who's to blame here? And I think sometimes we like to try to make ourselves the person to blame so that we can prove to others that we really love them, because we're afraid that maybe deep down inside that I'm not loved. And there's that guilt and the shame. And we're gonna talk about, that's a good point, keep that in mind. Wanting to feel bad for others, needing to care. And that's important. And that's a good, Gabby, you bring up a good distinction. Empathy versus feeling the need to be responsible for people. Because God would say in His Word, you don't need to be responsible for anyone. But yet I tell you, love your neighbor. And what's the motivation there? That's really the key. And that's what we're getting. Is it guilt or is it love that's motivating me? Is it law or is it gospel, if you want to put it in theological terms? And we sinful human beings who have two natures, a sinner and yet we're a saint, we struggle with that, which is why these emotions are so diabolical and something that Satan can use as a trap even our own hearts and minds can use to trap us up too. So just keeping those things in mind is good as we move forward here, because I want to just talk about, you know, the idea of people putting you on a guilt trip or you putting someone else on a guilt trip. And you know, if you've successfully put someone else on a guilt trip, it's because you've made them feel responsible. Because they allow you to do it to them. And that's maybe something to ask yourself, Terry. Do I allow this to happen to me?
Is it okay to make them feel responsible when they should be?
If they should be responsible and you want to hold them accountable, yeah.
So
but again, what's the reason? Is it retaliation or is it to remediate and to help them?
I'm so past helping them. It's like you should know this by now.
And you know what?
I think a lot of times it's easier to feel guilty than it is guilty and caring than it is to hold them responsible. Especially if the pattern has been like that for years, we just get overwhelmed and tired.
Yeah, because it's, well, there's a lot of baggage there, and it gets to be cumbersome. Now, to be honest, guilt, to a certain degree, is a good thing. I think we all would agree with that. That to some regard, we need a certain amount of healthy guilt, if you will, for a society to be able to function. We need something that holds us accountable and demands responsibility, because that's what elicits change usually. And we talked about that in the past too, that when the pain gets so bad that I can't take the pain anymore, finally, you know, the pain doesn't solve the problem, but the pain gets me finally off of my backside to do something about it. And guilt sometimes can be that painful little shot in the arm or wherever that gets us moving. But when the guilty feelings, the assigning of blame and responsibility, when that becomes too much for you to bear, then, you know, then we're on a guilt trip. And we're on a one-way ticket ride to Nowheresville, I guess. Now, I want to just flesh out the idea of looking at what are some of the, I guess, the ways that we deal with guilt. And I found three to be kind of, well, nice little hooks to hang things on. And denial, trying harder, comparing myself to other people. You ever used any of those? I think the whole idea of, you know, blaming other people to defend my position, you know, it's not my fault, it's yours. I didn't ask to be born, you know. That's meant to put mom or dad on a guilt trip, you know. I'm not the problem, you are. And, you know, which came first, the chicken or the egg? You know, which one's guiltier, I guess. So denying things. And, you know, I look at that from the point of view of our culture. And I think this is a really popular coping mechanism in our society, this idea of dealing with guilt. Well, to deal with it means you deny that there's anything to feel guilty about. And so, come up with a scenario, if you will, where somebody would maybe potentially feel guilty about something they're doing, but then they, in their mind, try to rationalize it in order to make themselves feel better about it. And put into a social context, something that we culturally deal with. You're doing something that goes against, and you said before, Rhonda, my conscience. Because I think that's where a lot of these guilt talks come from, my conscience. Conscience is good. Conscience does talk to me from the point of guilt. What might people do that goes against their conscience, but they really want to do it anyway, and so they try to talk themselves into it, or out of it, whichever aspect you want to look at.
Going 5 miles an hour over the speed limit.
Okay, going 5 miles an hour over the speed limit, a small infraction of the law, everybody's doing it, right? They're on the rational slippery slope, right, of relativism. You know, everybody's doing it. Even the cops go faster than the speed limit because I've seen them, and they're not chasing somebody, right? So why do you need to talk yourself into thinking that it's no big deal?
Well, you might have that person riding your tail that wants to go faster.
That's what the left lane's for. Yeah. Well, we are in the left lane.
Or the last 5 minutes of a school zone. Yeah. The ones that have the flashing lights. Everybody's in school already. There's no kids around.
So I can go 35 instead of 20. Yeah. Rules are meant to be broken, right? We hit on something that just happened.
I got a ticket going through the school zone.
Okay.
And I didn't feel guilty because I didn't know I was in a school zone.
There's one school where one of the signs is hidden behind a tree. She's like, did you know that there's a school zone off of 16th and 7th?
St. Paul's
Catholic School.
So to stop feeling guilty, I got to convince myself that I didn't do anything wrong. And that, you know what, it's not my fault. The tree branch was in the way. I didn't see it. Or, you know, it's school's in session. There aren't any kids out here. Come on. It's the spirit of the law, not the letter of the law. And there we see a little example of how we try to deny things and try to suppress or talk ourselves out of being guilty. Because remember, part of guilt is assigning blame. Guilt is taking responsibility for a wrong action. And we tend to try to talk ourselves out of that. I think of society in general, too, in the way, you know, look at social norms. I really love that guy. And I don't want to lose him. And so I want to prove that I love that guy. And so what's that young lady going to be tempted to think she needs to do to keep him? Well, my mom and dad said, you know, premarital sex isn't good. It's not God-pleasing. But, you know, that's irrelevant. I live by my own standards. Come on. You know what? And I really want this guy to stick around and like me and love me. Besides, you know, if I feel guilty about this, it's only because my parents told me it was wrong. And I don't know how many young kids have that kind of talk in their own head, trying to talk themselves into doing something or talking themselves out of feeling bad about doing it. I'm going to do it, so I'm going to talk myself into it, or I did it, and I got to talk myself out of it.
And then you got the worldview to back up.
Yeah, you got some social norms to back things up. I guess my question is, when you look at on your sheet there, denial, this approach, it really ignores the existence of God's will. Think about that. Does God want us speeding? No. Does God want us to have an unwholesome society? No. Why did he give us the family? It's the fabric of society. It's the building block for stability and all of those good things that come from having a mom and a dad and children in the nuclear family. It's something that God has created for our good and benefit. And we could take that and apply it pretty much to anything. But my question is, you got the rules that you've broken because you've decided they're irrelevant, and in place of those rules, you insert your own. But then what happens when you don't keep your own rules? And you don't live up to your own standards? Or you don't play by your own game? What if you break your own rules? You're right back where you started, aren't you? And I guess the question I have is, if we think of guilt as just a byproduct of some sort of rule set in us by family and cultural norms, then I guess my question is, if they don't really apply and they're not relevant and it's just some sort of cultural baggage and phenomenon and it's outdated and irrelevant, then why do people spend so much time trying to escape from guilty feelings if they really aren't real? So what is it that makes you feel guilty? Terry, you've been kind of sharing some experience. Have you ever played the denial game, or know people who have with you when it comes to dealing with things and family issues?
This is really hard.
How about as a parent, look at it from that point of view?
Just as a parent, I tend to, especially with people in my family, mental issues.
Okay.
I tend to look at these things and say, well, these are the three components that happen every day on a daily basis. The denial, you know, and then especially the comparison. Well, she does this.
Okay.
You know, why don't you have a problem with that? Or, you know, why are you mad at me all the time? You know, type of things. And so that's where my guilt comes, because I'm thinking, well, am I doing that? You know? Sometimes I don't feel like I'm even allowed to show disfavor.
So you hit on something, you know, mental disorders. You know, let's explore that. You're a parent of a child with some sort of disorder, a challenge, disability. Where's the guilt as that parent?
That they have it to begin with.
Who are you blaming? Because the guilt trip's gotta be assigned. Somebody's gotta get the ticket to ride. So who's getting the ticket there?
Oftentimes a parent.
Parent blames themselves, right? Maybe it's my bad genes that did it, or whatever. Or what I did or didn't do to take care of myself, you know, when I was having this child or before I got married or whatever it might be that we think about. And so that's a pretty heavy load of guilt. You're blaming yourself for something that you can't take responsibility for there. Because remember, we're talking about assigning responsibility. And you talked about, I forget what you said, wanting people to know you care. And so I want them to care so much that I'm willing to take responsibility for things so that they know I care. And I'm going to take responsibility for things that I don't even need to be responsible for, but I do it anyway out of an act of love. And that's a lot to put on a person. And then what do you do when you're carrying that big load? You try to overcompensate, don't you? And what do people usually do to overcompensate for guilt?
The second one, try harder.
Try harder. All right. Denial of God's principles and will, if it isn't a matter of God's will, really, that we're dealing with here, then why is there a question anyway about it, first of all? If it doesn't really matter and it's not important, then why am I bothered by it? Well, because it is important and it does matter. That's why I deny that. So let's move on to that one, comparison. Trying harder. The New Year's resolution syndrome. Anybody made any? It's what, the 12th? If you've made them, have you already broken them? What's that?
I haven't been to the gym yet.
Oh, you haven't been to the, so you haven't even started.
No.
It doesn't count until you start. So I'll make a resolution to exercise this year, but I'll start in June. You know, what's the syndrome? You know, what motivates people to want to change? I mean, what really motivates people to want to elicit change in their life?
They acknowledge acknowledge the problem.
They acknowledge the problem. They're not happy with what's going on in their life at the moment. Yeah. And they want change. And so you want that change, and you try harder to make the change, but what happens when you fail? So my motivation for my New Year's resolution, here's the guilt, you know, man, my pant size, they keep going up like my age, you know. I want to get back into my high school skinny jeans, you know, whatever. And first of all, why do people, New Year's resolution, for example, why do so many fail?
Unrealistic.
Taking responsibility for more than I need to, and being over aggressive and biting off more than I can chew, more than I need to handle, because I feel so responsible and I want to change, or I want to help that person change, and so I'm really committed to this, and I take on way too much, and I sign way too much to myself. And then you fail. So an unrealistic goal, I want to lose 50 pounds by March without having gastric bypass surgery or whatever, you know. Realistic?
No.
Kind of extreme, but follow it through. You don't make it, what happens then?
You fail.
So what do you do after you fail then? What happens?
Eat a tub of ice cream.
You eat a tub of ice cream. Why do we do that? Why do we do the very thing that's going to make it even worse than it was before? I want to lose weight, and I set this way unattainable goal. I can't meet it. I fail, and as a result, I eat a tub of ice cream. What did I have in the back of my mind the whole time?
You got the guilt, and got the self-soothing.
What did I think? What was I afraid I wasn't going to be able to do all along, even when I was making my goal and my resolution? Back in my mind, in your mind, what's creeping around there? Even when you think you're going to do it, what's still back there?
You're going to go back to bad habits.
Yeah, the fear that I'm not going to make it. I'm going to go back to bad habits. And well, you know what? Oh well, it's not my fault. I tried. Failed. And we do the opposite of what we set out to do, because guilt really works that way. It's so irrational. And I think of people that, you know, put themselves on these trips this way, and you know, you overcompensate in order to deny the bad feelings. Maybe you overeat, or you overexercise, or you overshop, or whatever the excess might be. People turn to drugs and alcohol sometimes as a way to soothe and to self-medicate. Maybe they fall into a depression, or they get all anxiety-ridden, and you know, they're manic or they're depressed, and they sleep too much, or they can't sleep. And the list goes on, and that cycle begins. And again, back to the question, why am I caught up in all of this if this really isn't an issue? It's because it is. In the back of my mind, I always have this fear that I'm going to fail. I always have this fear that I'm going to be abandoned by my loved ones. I always have this fear that they're going to accuse me of not being faithful and loyal to them. So therefore, I take on way more than I ought. But you know what? I'm so scared that this is going to be a self-fulfilling prophecy. And that's when guilt, if it's not dealt with, can turn subtly into shame. I'm going to talk about that in a little bit. What the differences are. But the last question on the sheet that I wanted to think about is, what happens when we start to do the old comparison? Can you follow the logic? Okay, there's denial. What, me worry? Nothing wrong here. It's his fault, not mine. It's your dumb rules. Fault, not mine. It's that tree branch in front of the 20 mile an hour sign, not whatever it might be. The denial, and then there's the try harder and I fail, and then there's the comparison. How does the comparison gig go?
Trying not to make it look so bad, because you know they didn't do it, or they've done it before.
Yeah, I might have you know, I might have, you know, buzzed through the 20 mile an hour school zone, but you know what? I've never molested a child. Wait, sometimes we jump to the extremes, don't we? I may have gotten mad at my kids, but I've never hauled off and, you know, beat them with a switch, or maybe they deserved it, I don't know. But you get the comparisons we make. At least I'm no murderer. And again, we're trying to self-medicate, aren't we? We're trying to soothe something that we can't soothe. My question I have for you under this one is, what happens if there's no one else there to compare yourself to? Because if you're riddled with guilt, you've already assigned all the responsibility and blame to yourself. What if there's nobody there to compare? What happens to you then? Who do you compare yourself to then?
Yourself.
What happens when you compare yourself to yourself?
It's like the resolution. You compare what you're trying to do.
Yes. What's actually happening?
What's happening in the past. And it just becomes a vicious circle.
You're stuck, right? You're stuck on a path that doesn't seem to have any sort of direction other than chasing your tail. I feel so responsible for this. I want to change it, but I can't. And I feel so responsible for this. I want to change it, but I can't. And you're the dog chasing the tail and going round and round. You know, and I take it back to the whole point of, you know, we sometimes deal with this comparison thing. It's self-righteousness is what it is. You want to put it in theological terms. It's, you know, it's the Pharisees in Jesus' day, you know. Why are you hanging around those tax collectors and sinners? You know, that whole approach of looking down upon other people and being very critical and judgmental of them. And we try to build ourselves up so that we can endlessly tear other people down in order to make ourselves feel better and superior. But again, when there's no one else but you to tear down, you go after yourself, don't you? Viciously. And I think of people who are dealing with a situation where you do have a loved one. Again, Terry, I don't mean to pick on because you brought it up, but I think that situation of having someone in your home, your family life, with a special need, a mental issue or a disability of some sort, I mean, you're going to be hard-pressed to find somebody else who shares exactly the same struggles you do. You can't compare yourself to somebody else because there's nobody else quite like you in this situation. And then I thought God doesn't give us more than we can handle. And everybody else seems to be doing just fine in all of this. And everybody else seems to cope so much better with life. I mean, come on. Now who are you comparing yourself to? Pardon?
Everybody else.
Yeah. Or God himself. Lord, if you really loved me, you wouldn't let this be happening to me. As if I dare am able to even begin to play the role of Job and stand up and brace myself and challenge God like that. And again, guilt forces us to do that, though. And then comes the shame part. And that's really, I think, the ugly mess that happens here. And so, when you feel like this, overwhelmed, it's kind of hard to find a way out. And I think Christians go down this path, especially Christians, because we are so susceptible and we're so sensitive to these things. Because our belief and faith system has a lot to do with guilt and forgiveness and sin and grace, and we're very keenly aware of these things. I feel so guilty. I get so depressed. I failed again. How can I approach God? How can I face my loved one? How can I look my child in the eyes after what I said or the thoughts I had? Or anybody been there? Start to just feel trapped like that. And I think anybody who's really concerned about growing as a Christian, we need to be aware of that. And so guilt, as we said before, a certain component of it is good. And so I wanted you to think about that statement there. This struggle of guilt, this, I feel so responsible. I failed again. I'm stuck in this. Guilty caught me red-handed. Is that a sign that God is working? Is guilt a sign that God's working in your life? And especially when you struggle with it.
I think guilt points us towards our sins.
Exactly. But who of us likes to be pointed towards our sins? And why?
It doesn't feel good.
Why doesn't it feel good?
Because we know it's against God's will.
Yeah, it goes back to, and if we know it's against God's will,
that we're acknowledging his existence then.
Yeah.
And that's why it weighs on us.
Exactly. But we don't like that, so that's why we rationalize it and try to come up with these ways to talk ourselves out of it, to get God out of it. Because if it really doesn't matter, and if I can convince myself that it doesn't matter, then it must not exist. But no. If I have to try so hard and work so hard to convince myself that it doesn't matter, that must just mean the very reality that it does matter. Because if it didn't, it wouldn't. And it points back to that whole reality. God in the middle of all of this. And it is the proof of his work. His will, even, you know, and it takes me to Paul in Romans 8, in all things God can work out good. Even when I'm dealing with a guilt trip, God can work out good there for me. Getting me personally to wrestle with this and understand it and conquer it. Or at least learn to check a few of the baggage, you know, the luggage at the counter before I get on. Whatever I need to do to be able to overcome this and be able to understand it. God's working here. And the things that don't work are denial, comparison, and trying harder. Because all of those, in some way, take God out of the equation. And they put me right in the middle and leaves us hopeless and helpless. Again, you pointed out right, Rhonda, guilt is a good thing if it gets us looking for the right cure. And that comes back to that whole thing. Pain doesn't heal. Now, if you leave pain unchecked, it just becomes an infection. But pain can be a great indicator as to how much I want healing. The greater the pain, the better chances I'm going to go to the doctor. The greater the pain, the better chances I'm going to turn to my Savior. And guilt can be one of God's great ways of measuring pain for me in order to get me to the cure. If you don't have the right cure, guilt can crush us because it leads to shame. Looking at this passage here from Psalm 32, part of David's life. Again, this is one of the hymns they sing for worship. And how many of you would like to write a hymn, first of all, and just bear all of your personal indiscretions and sins and problems, and let's say, here it is. Now I'm going to commission someone to put it to music, and we're going to print it up for public consumption, and we're all going to sing about it. How many of you would like to be that open and honest about your guilt? Rhonda, we're going to write a hymn about how awful I was this week, and we're going to sing it on Sunday. As long as it's you and not me, right? But this is what the Holy Spirit led David to do. In finding remedy to guilt. So open, so honest, brutally. I mean, talk about being naked, if you will. All of Israel was commissioned to sing this. And if anybody understands what David's talking about here, what's the great indiscretion in his life that he's coming clean on? want to talk about a guy that had guilt and tried to rationalize it. Think of David.
He was an adulterer.
He was an adulterer.
Murderer.
He was a murderer. He was a
thief.
Yeah, a thief. He was a despot in some ways. He was the, you know, he was the king of bloodshed. He was the one in whose house would always be a sword. Mm-hmm. I mean, his own family turned in Saul, you know, Absalom. He constantly had strife and civil war and all kinds of dysfunction. And we think we have some guilt. But yet, can you relate to him? How many of you have ever felt it like your bones, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long? Spiritual osteoporosis or something. I mean, his bones wasting away. I'm talking about this just achy. I'm starting to get a little bit of arthritis in some of my fingers. And, you know, and especially in the Midwest, when it really gets cold, they start to just, I can, you know, I know what he's taught you. How many of you have those pains? Probably greater than, in all of your body, yeah. Having rheumatoid arthritis of the soul is what David's talking about here. And groaning, all, why is he groaning? What's the only thing he can think about?
His guilt.
His guilt. He's gone through the denial, he's gone through the trying harder, he's gone through the comparisons, but there's nobody left to compare himself to because he's hit the rock bottom when it comes to guilt, and it's just him and his sin, and he is feeling hopeless and helpless. Day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. If left unresolved, and you know, thankfully that's not all David sings about there, which is why the Psalms are a great book to study of, you know, orientation, disorientation, reorientation. We talked about that, you know, you're going this way and then there's the whirlwind and then God works it out. David's in the middle of that. If left unresolved, and God didn't leave it unresolved, thankfully, but if left unresolved, what do you think is going to happen to that guilt? Was David there? It was completely eating him up. And this was a guy who pretty much had everything. King of a great nation. He had power, prosperity, popularity. But he could not soothe his soul. No matter how much he tried to numb himself, he could not take that pain away. That's guilt. And if left unchecked, you know, guilt has a way of giving quickly to shame. And I'd like to just talk about what guilt and shame look like.
Is his guilt a good guilt or a bad guilt?
I think David's guilt is just guilt. I don't think there's a good or bad guilt in the sense of, you know, there's a positive or a negative. I think all guilt is because I'm responsible for something I need to fix. Now, what do I do with it is the question. That's where the remedy comes in. How do I handle the guilt? Was David being too hard on himself?
No.
Are you being too hard on yourself? Or are you maybe not being hard enough on yourself? Or are you allowing others to be too hard on you? I mean, guilt, I think, is guilt. What do we do with it is really the answer. And if we don't do something with it, maybe this will help you, Terry, guilt turns into shame. And what is shame? Well, here's the difference. Guilt says, I made a mistake. Shame says, I am a mistake. Do you see this distinction? Guilt says, I made a mistake. Shame says, I am a mistake. Where are you? Somewhere in the middle? depends on the day. Balancing the line between guilt and shame. I made mistakes, but man, I've allowed it to get to the point where I blame myself, to the point that I'm worthless. And that's a really dangerous place to be as an individual.
If you have a Christian moment.
Yeah.
The shame part would be hard because I am a mistake. If I'm a child of God, it can't be a mistake.
That's why this is so irrational. And that's something, just kind of follow the thought through. Guilt says I did something stupid. Shame says I am stupid. Who's the one that wants to tell you that? Does God want, yeah, Terry, does God want you to know that? Who wants you to believe that? You know the answer. The old evil foe. My own sinful flesh. You know, even the world sometimes. You know, that this is where if we lay guilt trips on ourselves, they weave this tapestry of shame around us. And like burial cloths being mummified, we get caught up in it and we get trapped and stifled. I want you to look at kind of the idea of this, that, you know, how does guilt and shame work? Well, they work in us as individuals on different levels. God has made us in specific ways with different capacities. We have intellectual capacity. We have head smarts. We know things. We have emotional capacity. We have feelings. And then we have this volitional side, this desire, this drive, this will. I know something, I feel strongly about it, and now I move to do something, to act on it. I think we can see that in every part of who we are. You look at the Bible. The Bible talks about this in different ways. We can understand the Bible intellectually. We can learn facts and history about it. But then there's a real emotional connection to Scripture and the message it conveys in the Gospel. And then how that moves us to want to live according to it and to amend our lives. And to follow God. We already heard we're adding God's will back into it all. Now, if you look at that idea of emotions, and Terry, this might help you understand what we were thinking of your question there. Emotions have a specific use. I mean, basically, what are emotions? They're just, it's, and what are feelings? Where do they come from? They come from the brain. They come from the different, when we talked about this in the anger management one, you know, the different little parts of the brain producing the chemicals. And those chemical impulses interacting with the physical parts of the body, creating feelings, creating emotions. Emotions are nothing but chemical reactions within the body. You know, it's a physiological thing. And you ever been stressed out and tense in your back and your muscles are all tight and you just feel, oh. Because your emotions are high? It is a very holistic thing. Your emotions have a specific purpose. They propel us to act on knowledge and on our desires. If you feel really strongly about something, have an emotional connection to it, that's going to propel you to want to continue in it. And based on past experience, you get to that point. Now, emotions can, however, be subject to irrational thoughts. And irrational thoughts, again, based on knowledge or my lack of knowledge, bad knowledge, misguided knowledge, couple irrational thoughts with misguided emotions, that leads to dysfunctional actions and attitudes and beliefs. So an irrational thought would be, I have this situation, I've assigned way too much responsibility to myself, I'm dealing with this guilt, and my false belief is that I'm not doing enough. That's a false belief. And you have a false belief about yourself. And does that help to or does that muddy the waters even more? Understand what's going on inside of us when we're dealing with emotions. Just don't happen. They're kind of a result of what's going on in our lives, but they're also very much a part of why those things are going on in our lives.
Some people have more emotions than others.
Yeah, some people have more chemical, you know, imbalance, or maybe produce one particular chemical as opposed to another, serotonin versus keratin, or you know, adrenaline, or you know, and that kind of, that's what helps to partly develop personalities. Some people are just thrill seekers because their body's producing a lot more adrenaline than serotonin. And others, the opposite. Some people are very much introverted, others are very much extroverted. And I don't mean, you know, shy or outgoing, but I mean how they think, how they process their outside world. And it has a lot to do with the chemicals in their body and how they deal with things. Some people need to be around a lot of people and have a lot of activity going on in order to make decisions. And some people can be really quick and make rash decisions very clearly and quickly. Other people need to think it through and mull things over before they make a decision. You know, a sensing, feeling person versus a thinking kind of person. And again, there's where emotions based on chemical reaction coupled with physical and mental creates who we are and how we act. Now, is that bad? But who takes advantage of it? Who's the prince of this world? Who can even get into our heads and mess with our emotions? Satan himself. And yes, we are fearfully and wonderfully made, and we know more about, I think, the bottom of the ocean, which we know next to nothing about, than we know about the human body, let alone the brain. You want to talk about the great unknown frontier, it's not the seafloor, it's the brain. We don't have a clue as to how the brain works. But who does, besides God, is Satan. And he loves to mess with that. And he gets his little bony finger inside of there and he starts to really wreak havoc on us. Does that help put a little bit on, I mean, not to try to make it more scientific than we want it to be, because that's not the point of the class here tonight, but looking at this idea of, you know, understanding where emotions and feelings come from, especially guilt and shame. Shame takes the advantage of an irrational thought pattern and it latches itself onto a need that you have. Say for example, again, using the caregiver example. You feel guilty that you can't provide for that loved one, say, in a way that you would really like to, or in the way you see other parents or loved ones caring for their family. So you feel responsible. You feel accountable for that. You're letting your child down, perhaps you feel. You did something wrong. Your child's broken. You somehow are to blame. Shame takes advantage of that irrational thought pattern because those things are not true. Don't assign that responsibility to yourself. And it will take advantage of that irrational thought and it will attach itself to your need to want to be a good parent. And shame will cause you to feel vulnerable, it'll cause you to feel worthless, it'll help you to, you know, want you to internalize everything and, you know, fuel feelings of anger and hurt. And then you put up these false fronts, you know, which are meant to, you know, help you just deal with daily life. And it's like, if you ever known somebody who's going through a lot of guilt, they're those kinds of people that are just like on autopilot. They're just sort of there. There's probably something really, you know, still waters run deep, they say. You know anybody like that in your life who's really hard to get to know? They're sort of just numb, and they're there, but they're not. Chances are they're not shallow. Chances are there's probably a lot going on underneath the surface. And there's a lot of probably guilt and shame issues. Before we cause point cut off for tonight, because I wanted to put this into a two-part section here, and I was going to mainly cut off halfway through the middle of the next page. Origins of shame. I want to talk about that. And then just get into a little bit of discussion on scripturally speaking. Because we could talk all day long about the physiological, you know, and the mental and physical and emotional makeup. But scripturally speaking, spiritually, where does shame come from? And when I mention shame, I think of one section of the Bible that I think we all know pretty well, and that's the third chapter in Genesis, which is also known as the fall into sin. If you want to open your Bibles there quickly, because we're going to look at just that section of Scripture and then Psalm 51:5, and then we'll cut it off for this evening. Look at it from the intellectual, the emotional, and that, you know, that will or volition side of people. Look at how the devil is so, again, keen on understanding our makeup as human beings in God's image. And I think that comes out in the very first verse. Anybody care to read verse 1, chapter 3, Genesis?
Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?"
Okay, first of all, the description of the serpent. We don't know what the serpent was. It was a serpent. Some sort of, I don't know, we usually think of a snake, right? But apparently he had some way of moving around. A lizard. I don't know what it was, but God doesn't really get into describing the physical characteristics of this animal. He's talking more about the less tangible characteristics, the personality of this animal. And how does Moses describe it here in verse 1?
And he was crafty.
Yeah, what does it mean? He was more crafty than all of the other animals in the garden that God had made. Are snakes crafty, first of all?
No, I don't think so.
They're kind of stupid. Yeah. I don't know.
Depends on the definition.
Okay, well, yeah, it depends on the definition, okay?
And I had a snake, one of my friends had a snake that ended up in the apartment building's air duct system.
Snakes are pretty industrial. They're sneaky, yeah. I mean, you know, Sneaky Snake goes dancing and drinks all the time. There's a song about him, I remember. I don't remember how it went, but why do we think this might be a quality trait worth focusing on? He was more crafty, this one, than all the other animals that God had made. And especially, it's the Lord God here. So this is not Elohim God, this is Lord God, this is the second person of the Trinity, the pre-incarnate Jesus Christ, the Son that we're referring to here with the Lord God. Who made him? Who made the snake? The serpent?
Jesus.
Does he make anything bad? Or is all that God does and make good?
We became bad.
We became bad?
Yeah, well, yeah.
But yet, are we inherently bad? Or are we fallen? I mean, this is the thing that people struggle with, you know, humanity is sinful. No, we are corrupted. But by being human, by virtue of being human, that does not make us bad. Because God made us. We are corrupted in our sinful nature. That does not mean that our human nature inherently is bad. Because if it were inherently bad to be human, then when Jesus became a baby, and one day when we have the physical eternal resurrection with body and soul in heaven, that can't be bad. The fallen state of it is bad. The essence of it is not. The essence of this creature is not bad, that it's crafty, that it's sneaky perhaps. And last of all, I mean, did the animals all in the garden talk? I mean, was this Dr. Doolittle kind of stuff going on? Where Adam and Eve could talk to the animals?
There's a good possibility.
We don't know. But the case is here, this one could. So.
Well, and God also walked around in the garden, though.
Yes, in the cool of the day, he would come in physical form, yes. I have no idea what heaven was like then in this Garden of Eden, because this is heaven, basically, on earth. Perfection. I have to wonder, did serpents talk? I don't know. They must have, because it didn't, I don't know, they could, is Eve surprised by it? That's what I was.
Yes. Put off.
So, good questions. So she's not taken aback by this. The serpent comes and asks a question. And the question is meant to create what?
Doubt.
Doubt regarding whom?
Regarding what?
Regarding whom? Doubt in whom?
God. Herself.
Herself and also God. You're both right. Doubting God and then doubting herself in relation to where does she fit into God's plans here? In other words, can I trust God and is he holding out on me or isn't he? Has he really got my best interests in mind? We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat the fruit from the tree that's in the middle of the garden, and you must not even touch it, or you will die. And God never said that part, but Eve just kind of adds the connection that, you know, if I'm going to eat it, I'm going to touch it. So if I'm going to touch it, that means I'm implying I'm going to eat it. So it's better to just not even go near it and not even touch it. Because in her mind, touching it was eating it. So she was being very clear in saying she understood what responsibility was assigned to them. Yeah, we know what God wants. We know his will. They're not ignorant of it. And then how does the serpent answer in verse 4? Is it a question? Mm-hmm. It's a contradiction.
You won't die.
Yeah, a bold-faced lie. Flat out. Tie that into the rationalization of guilt. Guilt is ignoring God's will in something. They're not ignorant of God's will. They understand his will. But at the same time, guilt is also about, you know what? It's about that denial. It's about changing the rules. They don't apply to me. Oh, you're not going to die. We're going to change the rules. Does not apply. For God knows that if you eat this fruit, your eyes are going to be open and you're going to be like him, knowing good and evil, as if that's a good thing. I mean, let's look at it. Now, how's that going for us, we human beings, being able to know the difference between good and evil? We know the truth, but, you know, can we handle that truth? We got a pretty bad track record on handling that truth well, don't we? I mean, look at all the crud that's going on in the world. Even in this day and age where we think by now we should have everything all figured out, we still have senseless, violent killings going on. We don't know how to handle good and evil. But the devil's saying, let's change and reassign the rules and responsibilities. So, who does the devil want Adam and Eve to blame? Why does he want them to blame God? So what could they then do for themselves? Blame others in order to defend my position. Blame God in order to find a way to defend what I've done wrong so that I don't have to deal with guilt. So it happens. And you walk through it. We know the rest of the story.
Adam and Eve, they eat the fruit. It looks good to them. Ooh, it's desirable for wisdom. We'll get to know good and evil. Yeah, that's awesome. Because all we know is good. And that's boring. I like just a little good once in a while. Evil's too chaotic. Now, if you look at the end, verse 7, what happens after they eat the fruit?
They automatically become guilty.
How do they know they're guilty?
Because their eyes were open.
Their eyes were open to what?
The difference between
good. Difference between good and evil. The difference between self-control and lust. Between innocence and having that diabolical sense. And what did they look and see about each other? That they were both naked. So what did they do?
They covered up.
Question I have there on the sheet for you is this. How has Adam and Eve's single act of disobedience impacted all of humanity here? Do you see, in other words, do you see shame in that verse there? Mm-hmm. What does shame have to do with the fall here? When you're facing guilt, you have two alternatives. Remember how God wants to use guilt?
To turn to God or turn away.
Yeah. There's that fork in the road. Turn to Him or turn to myself. If I turn to myself, then what do I got to do with my guilt? I got to somehow deny it. I got to somehow compare myself to others, find somebody to blame, or I somehow rationalize it and I try harder to cancel it out. Can't do that because it doesn't work. So what did Adam and Eve do? Why'd they cover themselves up?
Shame.
They felt shame.
They felt shame. I am a mistake. Not I made a mistake, but I am a mistake. Mm-hmm. We are unworthy of standing in God's presence. And so we're going to hide among the trees. He can't find us. That verse right there, single act of obedience, has impacted all of us ever since. We call it inherited sin, original sin. And then we question, why do I feel guilty at times, and why do I deal with shame? Gee, if you want to blame somebody, who should we blame? It's all your fault, Adam and Eve. It's not mine. The devil made me do it. You know, remember, that's what Adam and Eve tried to do. Oh, was that talking snake? No, it was that woman you gave. And then God said, what is this you've done? Who? Remember, who told you you were naked? That's how God deals with it. It's not about, I'm not concerned about them, about your comparing, your denying, or whatever, but who told you you were naked? Why are you ashamed? Because are you trying to hide some guilt that you need to confess? So come clean. Don't be so hard on yourself. Don't be your own savior. Stop fighting a battle that He's already won for you. And if you turn to Psalm 51, verse 5. Right there, I have it on our sheet there if you'd like to look at it. If we are sinful at conception, and David says that, surely I was sinful from birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Taking it and coupling that with Genesis chapter 3, if we are sinful at conception, then what does that mean about humanity at the time we're conceived? What also do we have the capability of having in our hearts?
Shame
and guilt. That little zygote in the womb has shame and guilt impacted right into its little DNA baggage. It's all part of who we are. So, if we can't change it because it's something that's now inherent in the system, then why do we try to come up with ways to fix it? Rhetorical question. Because we're stupid, right? Last question then, as we break off here, and I want to jump into next time looking at shame and how it develops throughout more human development and into our lives, but put Christ Jesus in the middle of all this now. How is he the remedy to guilt and shame? If guilt is something, if guilt is being responsible for something I know I've done wrong, how does Jesus remedy that as being the chosen Son of God, the Savior? How does he deal with guilt, which is that I made mistakes?
He forgives you.
How does he forgive you? What did he do with the guilty as charged? I've made a mistake.
He took my guilt.
He took your guilt by redeeming you, by paying the price with his life and his death. He paid my guilt and that accountable debt that I'm responsible for. Now, shame is I'm worthless. I am a mistake. How does Jesus remedy that? Again, follow it through. If he was willing to pay your price to guilt and pay what you're responsible and the debt only that's assigned to you, what does that say about how much you mean to him?
You're not worthless. You're precious.
And shame is, I'm a mistake. And Jesus says, if you're a mistake, then me dying for you was a mistake. But no, the opposite is true. And that's really the power of what we find in the redemption of Jesus Christ. You are valuable. Yes, I've paid your guilt. But because you're that worthwhile to me. And it's an undeserved love, which we call grace. And there, God's will gets inserted right back into the remedy. God wants this for us. And he wills it for us. Guilt always wants to take his will out of it. Grace puts it right back in. And shame wants us to take responsibility for all of it. Grace says Jesus is taking responsibility for all of it. And that's a very freeing, it's not going to change your life overnight and make you the prince of Egypt or the princess of Wales, or, you know, we're not going to have money, you know, flying down and hear gospel of prosperity. No, but talking about freedom of conscience and peace of mind, and a better understanding of who I really am in God's eyes, helps me now then to be a little less hard on myself in some regards, but to trust God to work where I need him to work on me, and to be bold enough to confess to him where I'm wrong and trust in his love to carry me through, and let him be responsible for the things that we cannot. So I want to stop there. And shame, humanity, how it develops and shapes us. There's a lot of Bible passages I want to focus on, and then getting into Romans a little bit, because there's a lot of great stuff in there about the remedy to living a Christian life in triumph when we look at the book of Romans. So I'm going to break that off right there. And we've gone a little bit over it than I wanted to, but I wanted to get to that breaking point where at least it felt like a nice segue. Does anybody got any thoughts or questions before we cancel off here? I see a couple pens to the right. There aren't. With that said, any prayers? Just good spiritual health?
Yes.
How about that? Did I cover it?
Yep.
Okay, we'll ask for that. Lord God, we thank you for the promised blessings we have in your Son, Jesus. When we look at ourselves, all we see is the worst of our worst. But when we look at ourselves through you, we see who we truly are in your eyes, that we are forgiven and redeemed and restored. Thank you for that blessing, to know that you see us as your children, that you see us as forgiven children. You see us as children of great value and worth, people who have purpose, and you've assigned lasting value to our lives. Never let our sins or Satan or our own conscience or even this world, never let them lead us to doubt you, to lead us to believe these false lies that you don't care for us, you don't love us. Instead, we see in you a perfect love, a love that's paid our guilt, and a love that loves us so much because we are worth that much. You are not ashamed of us. Help us to know that we don't need to be ashamed of ourselves either then, because you love us that much. Fill us with your esteem, Christ, with your love, to know that because of you, we have purpose and meaning and lasting value. Bless us tonight as we go home. Keep us safe as we close our eyes this evening. May our final thought be that we are your child, dear God, and that you will keep us in your loving care now and always. It's in Jesus' name we pray.